Good afternoon. You know, you're picking the right day to worship the Lord. Today is Sabbath. Sabbath is from Friday evening to Saturday evening, and you're picking the right day. This is the day that our Lord rested. Praise the Lord. I'm so glad to be back here. My tennis partner continues to punish me. I used to play tennis with Derek very often, and he will not give one quarter, I will not give one quarter, and we're fighting in the courts all the time. It was good fun. Okay. All right, today I thought I'd talk to you about something called the miraculous and incredible life of Jesus Christ. The study of Jesus Christ is so wide and extensive, and many books have been written about him. I don't think there will be an end to books about Jesus. In this message today, I will try and cover two aspects of the life of Jesus. We'll see. We'll talk about his miracles, the miracles of Jesus, and which is continuing today, by the way. Today, if you dare to stretch out your hands in faith, you will see the miracles of Jesus continuing. And we see many, many miracles in our healing rooms. It's ordinary volunteers, believers like you, stretching out their hands in faith, believing in the power of the Holy Spirit, and we see mighty and wonderful miracles. So it's continuing today. I see it all the time in the crusades that we run in Pakistan. Muslims coming sick, infirm, blind, and we see Jesus wonderfully open their eyes. So he's continuing his ministry these days to us. But there's something about his miracles that he's teaching us. All right, a miracle is a phenomenal or supernatural event in the physical world that supersedes all known natural laws or powers. Okay. But God never operates contrary to his word or to the laws of nature which he has established. He has, however, the prerogative to supersede them as he sometimes does, and we call that a miracle, when God supersedes the natural order of things. If you look at your New Testament, the Gospels describe about 30 miracles. 30 miracles. So many miracles are done that they can't write all in the book, but the Gospels outline 30 miracles. I want you to note that in the Gospel of John, there are only 7 miracles known. 7, all right? The rest he discarded. Why is that so? I tell you one of the reasons. If we look in John chapter 20, John 20 verses 30 and 31. And truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and believing you may have life in his name. So the Gospel of John is a gospel of belief. It's a gospel of belief, right? But what are the main reasons for his miracles? There is a reason. It's just not done. He's done out of compassion. He's done out of mercy. But there are reasons for the miracles that Jesus does. All right? His glory. Miracles show and demonstrate in a significant way his glory. Right? In John 1:14, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father. Miracles demonstrate his glory. Miracles point to Jesus as the Son of God. Miracles point to Jesus as the Son of God. When I go to Pakistan, I go to India, or I go to Siberia, and I preach the gospel, I always, after I preach the gospel, I will pray for the sick. And when we pray for the sick in the name of Jesus, He heals them. And they come out and testify. And the unbelievers, the Muslims in Pakistan, see the miracles of Jesus and they believe. And the next day, they bring their friends and they bring many more Muslims to come and listen to the gospel of Jesus Christ. It points the way to Jesus. There's nothing they can argue with. If I say Jesus heals and I pray for the sick and Jesus heals, there's nothing else to argue. No theology, no doctrine, no nothing. It's just straightforward healing. So Jesus, the miracles point the way to Jesus. Listen to John chapter 10, verse 38. But if I do, though you do not believe me, believe the works that you may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. Okay? Each miracle gives us something of eternal value we can use today. I'm sure in your school of natural, supernatural, which Derek runs and he talks to you about healing, there should be a place in the healing miracles that we can extract what we see from each miracle. It teaches us something. But today we're not going to that. Maybe next time when he feels like inviting me again. He's gone somewhere, right? That's why he invites me. Let's look at the first miracle in the book of John. The first miracle is water turns to wine. Water turns to wine. Jesus and his disciples are invited to a wedding in Cana, and then they ran out of wine. That's a very embarrassing thing to do because you're supposed to make your guests happy. And they're not happy. They say, what? No wine now. What kind of wedding is this? Lao ya wan, let's go home. Okay? So what happened was the mother of Jesus went to Jesus, listen, son, they run out of wine. Of course, Jesus said, what's that got to do with me? Anyway, and Mary said to the servants, whatever he tells you to do, do it. Okay, whatever he tells you to do it, do it. So Jesus asked them to fill up these 6 pots, which of stone used for purification. They have almost 150 gallons in it. And take them to the master of ceremony. And this is what the master of ceremony said. Every man at the beginning set out the good wine. And when the guests have well drunk, then that which is inferior. But you have kept the good wine until now. The good wine. When Jesus turned the wine, it was a good wine. All right? So what do we learn from this miracle, okay? Firstly, the Bible says, John 2:11 says, he manifested his glory and his disciples believe in him. All right. Then he demonstrated that he was not only the master of chemistry. Water into wine, you got to change the chemical composition. So he was a master of chemistry. Right. But he was also the master of quality. He just didn't change it in wine. Even the wine master said, wow, this wine is good. He was a master of quality, water into wine. Then you notice that miracles are born out of obedience. Miracles are born out of obedience. Mary says to the servants, whatever he says to you, do it. All right? This is a simple requirement for a miracle. This is linked to the miraculous survival of the Jewish race 1,700 years earlier. There was a famine in Canaan, all right? In Genesis 41, verse 55. Famine in Canaan. And then Jacob asked his sons to go to Egypt. They heard there is food there. And they survived there because they went to Egypt. And then when the 7 lineages came, all the Egyptians got no food. So they came to Joseph, all right? They came to the Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said this, go to Joseph, whatever he says to you, do. You see the similarity? Whatever he says to you, do. And of course, he fed them and they went through the 17 years. Whatever he says to you, do. Miracles are born out of obedience. Right. The second miracle, Christ heals the nobleman's son in John 4, verses 46 to 54. You can read that yourself. I just want to draw, what is a lesson from this miracle? All right. Christ demonstrates that he is the master of distance and of power. He says, go your way, your son is healed. He's far away. He's the master of this distance and the power of his spoken word. Go your way, your son is healed. The power of his spoken word brought the healing to the nobleman's son. And you can see this in Romans chapter 4, verse 14. He calls what is not into being. He calls what is not into being. I don't know whether any of you remembered some years ago, in Church of Our Savior. You're all ex-Church of Our Savior, right? I'm also ex-Church of Our Savior. During the pause in worship, the Lord gave me a word. The Lord gave me a word, right? And I went up to the front and I said, listen, the Lord is showing me that body parts are falling. How many people remember that? Body parts are falling down. All right? And people stood up by faith to catch those body parts. One of the testimonies the week after that, there was a lady. The husband had a very bad heart, was due for to go in for operation. All right? It's bad. They had to operate. They had to do something. And so the husband went after that. She stood in proxy for the husband. Husband went after that. And the doctor examined him before he did the operation. And he said, what's happened? You almost got a new heart. You got a heart as strong as a baby. You call what is not into being. You speak that into being. Many times in the crusades, in the healing, you know, listen, when I go to a crusade, praise the Lord, there are tens of thousands of people. Okay? When I ask for healing, thousands stand up. If I were to go down and lay hands on these people, after I lay hands, they will have to pray for my hand. So what I do is I call them, come up to the front, and wherever they need prayer, to lay their own hands in their body part. And I will, as the Holy Spirit prompts, I will call out the healing in the name of Jesus. Blind eyes be open, cripples walk, paralyzed limb walk. Just call it out, okay? And then when I finish praying, I said, those of you who are healed, put up your hands. And they will put up their hands. I said, come up to testify. And they will come out and testify. I was blind, now I can see. I was paralyzed. I've been paralyzed for so many months. I can't walk. Now I can walk. We make them walk. It's calling what is not into being. The power of the word. Jesus showed this here. Go your way. Tell the nobleman, your son is healed. Okay? So this Jesus is the master of distance and power. Then after he does that, what's the result? He himself believed and his whole household believed. The nobleman believed and his whole household. Several months ago, I was in Pakistan. We have a TV station. And I did a crusade on TV. I preached the gospel on TV. I asked for a response. And later they said there were many people responded. I also prayed for the sick. And I said, lay your hands on yourself as you watch the TV. I'm going to pray for the sick. Okay, so I just call out again as the Holy Spirit prompts out the healing he wants to do. I just call out over the and then they receive it over the TV. There was a woman in I'm in Lahore, okay? There was a woman in Karachi. It's like a 500 kilometers away. And she laid hands on her stomach. I think a few weeks later, she came to the church in Lahore to give a testimony that she had a tumor that was 1 kg. And as a prayer was given, the tumor disappeared. Completely disappeared. The power of the spoken word. We call what is not into being. And this is what is demonstrated here by Jesus, all right? But this is also another lesson here. What's the lesson we learned here? It's a lesson in hope of faith, hope of faith. The official son was lying down, going to die, okay? Jesus is teaching on hope and faith, because faith is the opposite of doubt. Go your way, your son lives. That's what Jesus said to him. Now, the nobleman understood that if Jesus had the power to heal, it would follow that Jesus could do it without having to be physically present. Okay? Jesus was Lord. He's Lord over distance. Jesus showed us that blind faith actually is enough. Blind faith is just faith in Him. When faith and obedience are operating together, there is no limit to what can happen. Faith is believing Jesus can heal. Go your way is obeying. You go your way. And when that happened, the son rose up. Faith and obedience can work wonders. The third miracle, the man at the pool. John 5, 1 to 18. What's the lesson from this miracle? The long illness of the man, 38 years of sickness would indicate helplessness, right? 38 years you've been sick, you know. From a physical standpoint of view, probably psychological hopelessness, right? Psychological. Resigned to his fate. Out of the many sick in the pool, Jesus chose one. Remember in the pool around them, there were many sick, but Jesus chose one. He was going to give a lesson. The miracle shows one thing, his mastery over time. The man was sick 38 years ago. Jesus reached down the eons of time and touched him and healed him. It also demonstrates his desire in restoring those who have been reduced to utter helplessness, as this man was, right? Both in body and in spirit. What the first question Jesus asked him? Do you want to be made well? His answer is not an affirmative. I mean, if I'm sick, you ask me, do I want to be made well? I say, yes, please, pray for me. But this man's answer was, he gave an excuse. Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred, but while I'm coming, another steps down before me. That's an excuse. When a person is devoid of hope, they tend to spend their time creating emotional defense. Why are you not healed? You know, many, many reasons. So what did Jesus say? Arise, take up your mat and walk. Jesus asked the man to take action. Take action, do something for his own healing. He had given up. Arise, take up your mat and walk. So he had to do something if he wanted to be healed. So he spoke healing into being. Romans 4:17, call what is not into being. And as the man obeyed, he was made well. Okay? Another fourth miracle, simple miracle, feeding the 5,000. 5,000 men plus women, probably about 20,000 people. He fed them adequately from 5 loaves and 2 fishes. The lesson from this miracle is he's the God of all sufficiency. He's a God of all sufficiency. From 5 loaves, he fed 20,000 people. Right? Jehovah Jireh. He owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. Psalm 50 verse 10. And it was also a teaching moment because after that, immediately after that, he says, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, but he who believes in me shall never thirst. John 6:35. The fifth miracle is walking on water. Jesus walking on water, all right? You all know that miracle. What's the lesson from this miracle? This miracle revealed his power over nature and contributed to the picture of his deity. A supernatural control over the physical elements. He allowed his disciples to see that he is Yahweh. Yahweh. Job declares in Job chapter 9, verse 8 regarding Yahweh. Listen to this. He alone spreads out the heavens and treads on the waves of the sea. His disciples, they know the scripture. And Jesus walking on the sea must somehow connect their mind with Job chapter 9, verse 8. He alone spreads out the heavens and treads on the waves of the sea. Jesus walking on water. Let's look at the sixth miracle. Christ heals a blind man. John chapter 9, verse 1 to 11. The man was born blind. He never had sight, okay? He was born blind. The day he was born, he was blind. Religious teaching at that time, the popular religious teaching at that time is, if you or your parents did something wrong, God is upset and brings his sickness onto you. This is the prevailing teaching at that time, okay? That's why the disciples of Jesus asked Jesus, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he should be blind? Okay, this is their thinking. Who sinned? What did Jesus answer? Neither did this man sin nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. Okay, Jesus chose to heal the man. You remember the man didn't even ask for healing. Why you can know the man ever asked for healing? He was blind. He didn't even know Jesus was there. Right? He was blind. He didn't know who Jesus was. He didn't even know Jesus was there. But Jesus chose him for a purpose. He chose him in that instant to teach both the man and the disciples that the religious thought process of the time was not valid. Neither this man sinned nor his parents sinned. Okay? The man's healing also depended on his obedience. Here you see obedience again. Obedience. His willingness to obey the command of Jesus to go to wash in the pool of Siloam. As he washed in the pool of Siloam, I presume the eyeballs just became part of him. I presume he had no eyeballs. He had nothing in the eyes. Born blind. Or maybe he had eyeballs. It doesn't matter. The moment he washed and obeyed, his eyesight came back. The seventh miracle, last and greatest of Jesus' public miracles recorded by John, brought the final demonstration. His mastery over life and death, a convincing proof of his claim to be, I am the resurrection and the life. Complete mastery over death. The final miracle proved once and for all that Jesus Christ was the promised Messiah foretold by Isaiah years earlier, that we can have eternal life in him. Lazarus provided an irrefutable proof that he is the Son of God. I am the resurrection and the life. So I submit to you that the seven miracles in John was carefully selected to, it's a teaching moment to teach us about Jesus Christ, to teach us about him, and to teach us about healing. But I want to share today now something which I find really incredible. Thousands of years ago, the psalmist expressed this amazement in Psalm chapter 8, verse 3 to 5. When I consider the heavens, the work of your fingers, what is man that you consider him? What is man that you visit him? The psalmist is so amazed. He looks at the wonders of God. He says, what is man that you consider us? What is man that you visit us? You visit us, you know? I take you up to heaven, and let's imagine a conversation between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. All right? Even before the world was formed, the Trinity was having a conversation. Father, Son, Holy Spirit sitting together, and they were talking as, you know one thing, God is love. God is love. And love must be poured out into someone. If I have love, I have to show it, I have to pour it out into someone. I love my children, I have to pour it out into him. So I have to have someone to pour my love out to. God is love. So God spoke to the Trinity, let's create a family. Let's create Adam Let's create Eve. A family he can pour out his love into. From Adam and Eve, he would have many, many people. But you also know that God sees the end from the beginning. All right? He sees that he's going to create Adam and Eve, and he sees the consequences of what was going to happen. All right? So God wanted to create this family, but he knew what was going to happen. And he was speaking to the Trinity, they will sin. They will sin. Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. They will rebel, and they will be lost. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus is the only way. He told his son, you will proclaim the good news. Some will believe you, and some will not. They will beat you. They will even kill you. This is necessary, for only you, in your sinless perfection, can atone for the sins and bring them back home to me. Right? Here is this Trinity having a conversation, talking about what's going to happen in the world. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22, according to the law, almost all things are purified with blood, and without shedding of blood, there is no remission. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. So God says to Jesus, they will kill you. Because without shedding of blood, there is no remission. And what did Jesus do? Jesus agreed, yes, Father, I will go. Hebrews 9:28, so Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. He became the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Revelation 13, verse 8. This incredible Son of God, our Savior, and the prophet Isaiah says of him, who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hands. The waters in the world are measured in the hollow of his hands. Who has measured heaven with a span? Heaven is billions and billions and billions of light years across. Who has measured it with a span? And calculated the dust of the earth in a measure. Weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance. Isaiah 40 verse 12. This wonderful Son of God. And the psalmist says, brother, lift up your eyes and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number. He calls each one by name. Do you know each one of the stars? The Lord has called each one by name. You know how many stars there are in heaven? There are trillions and trillions and trillions of stars. So our King of glory, the Lord Jesus Christ, to restore to the Father his family, came as a helpless baby and became like us. And when he grew up, he preached the good news of the kingdom of God. Our amazing and incredible Savior came as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Philippians chapter 2, verse 8. This Son of God, who flung stars into space, surrendered his hands to cruel nails on the cross for you, for me. Incredible. He who flung stars into space surrendered his hands to cruel nails for us. Slain from the foundation of the world. When Jesus agreed, the plan was put in motion. God put the plan in motion. His coming was prophesied. From Genesis, he was prophesied already. Genesis chapter 3, verse 14 to 15. He will bruise your head and you will bruise his heel. It was prophesied, the coming of Jesus. You will bruise his heel. Why would Jesus' heels be bruised? When you are crucified on the cross, I mean, your whole body cannot be hung up by those nails. You're just crucified into your hands or the wrists, you see, and they can't hold you up. So what happens is, when you hang on the cross, your whole body goes down and presses on your lungs and you cannot breathe. And what the people who do who are crucified on the cross is, with their heels on the back, upright on the cross, they wedge themselves up so they can breathe. As they keep doing it, they bruise their heel. So this is what God said at the beginning. You will bruise his head and he will bruise your heel. From the beginning of time, God prophesied the coming of Jesus Christ. In Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Let's look at Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Isaiah, all right, chapter 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Isaiah, 750 years before Christ was born, prophesied the coming of Jesus Christ. And the manner of his coming was prophesied. So Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, he was born of a virgin. He was born of a virgin, verse 14. Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. That's the manner of his calling. And you find this in Luke 1, chapter 27, verse 33. Why virgin? Why coming from a virgin? Why send Jesus to be born of a virgin? Remember, from the beginning of time, the reason we got into this mess was because Adam and Eve disobeyed God, and because they disobeyed God, sin entered into humanity. So sin was in the bloodstream of Jesus, of humanity. Now, when an egg is conceived in the mother's womb, the mother's blood, once it's conceived, has nothing to do with the egg. So Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit. He was conceived by God. And at no time did the mother's blood was tainted by sin got into the bloodstream of Jesus Christ. Jesus had the blood of God pumping through his veins. The sinless, pure blood of God pumping through his veins. That is why he had to come from a virgin. Micah chapter 5 verse 2. It prophesied that he would be born in Bethlehem. He'll be born in Bethlehem. What's the reason for his coming? God tells us why he had to come. Isaiah 53, verse 4 to 6. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned each one his own way. And the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. The Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. He came to take the sins that you and I have committed. Isaiah 53, verse 4 to 6. And you talk about the reason for his coming is Leviticus 17 verse 11. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. He had to shed his blood. Hebrews 9, 22, 26. Let's look at Hebrews 9, 22, 26. Hebrews 9:22. And according to the law, almost all things are purified with blood, and without shedding of blood, there is no remission. That's what Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11 says. And 28. So Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time apart from sin for salvation. What does blood do? When he shed his blood, what does it do? If you look at the psalmist in Psalm chapter 103, verses 11, 12. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from him. How far is the east from the west? Somebody can tell me how many miles? How far? How far? As far as the east is from the west. Infinity. There's no distance. That's how far he has removed our sins because of the shed blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And this was prophesied. The manner of his death was also prophesied. If you read Psalm 22, the whole Psalm 22 is a prophetic utterance of the manner of Jesus Christ's death. The first words of Psalm 22 was, my God, why have you forsaken me? That's what Jesus cried out on the cross. Psalm 22 talks about his hands and his feet being pierced. In Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10, they will look on him whom they have pierced. So all the prophets and the Psalms prophesied the coming of Jesus Christ. Do you remember in the gospel when there were two people walking to Elamas and Jesus appeared to them, talked to them, had supper with them, then disappeared. And he said, and Jesus talked to them and he says, why are you all so sad? Why the whole town so sad? He said, didn't you hear about Jesus Christ being crucified? So Jesus in the Bible says, from the Psalms and the prophets expounded to them why this must be so. I'm sure he expounded probably all these verses and more why Jesus must be crucified. I would have been that. I've always said I would have loved to hear what Jesus said, but I believe this is a smattering of what Jesus would have provided from them, from the Psalms and the prophets. You know, on the cross of Calvary, in John chapter 19, verse 28 and 30, as Jesus hung on the cross, and he says, after this, Jesus knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled. That the scripture might be fulfilled. What's a scripture? Isaiah 43. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. By his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned each one his own way. And the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. When he hung on the cross and he knew that this scripture had been fulfilled. You know what did Jesus do? Jesus gave up his spirit and said, it is finished. It is finished. The scripture prophesying about this has been accomplished. That's what he's done on the cross of Calvary. John 19, verses 28. So at the cross of Calvary, love and mercy met at the cross. When the blood flowed from the cross, it flowed forgiveness. It flowed justification. It flowed innocence, not guilty. Peace. Healing. By his stripes we are healed. And redemption. And I tell you something. This is still crying out today. For the unsaved of the world, this is still crying out today. And I really would like to see each one of you burdened with what the Lord has done and cry out to this world, to the unsaved. Forgiveness. Peace. Redemption. All this that flowed from the cross of Calvary. And you know, God leaves his footprints everywhere. In Romans 1:20, for since the creation of the world, His invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead. God leaves his footprints everywhere on what he has done. There are trillions of stars in the universe. Trillions. And there are at least 30,000 galaxies. 30,000 galaxies. Every second, one star is born. The nearest star to us is Proxima Centauri. Proxima Centauri is 4.22 light years away from us. One light year is 186,000 miles times 60 times 60 times 24. It's 16 billion miles. One light year is 16 billion miles away, okay? To give you an idea, the sun is 93 million miles away from us. One light year. That's one light day, sorry. One light year is 5,840 billion miles from us. The sun is only 93 million miles from us, and we take the furthest planet from us, which is Neptune, it is 2,702 million miles, 0.006 light years away. Proxima, our nearest star is 4.22 light years away. Do you know the Hubble telescope was invented? It was one of the greatest inventions. And they peered into the universe and they found many galaxies. Our galaxy is called the Milky Way. And the Milky Way is 120,000 light years in diameter. You remember, one light year is 5,840 billion miles. Our galaxy is 120,000 light years in diameter. Our closest galaxy is the Andromeda Galaxy, 2.5 million light years away. These are all peered by from the Hubble telescope. These are all taken from the Hubble telescope. After the Andromeda Galaxy, you come to the Cigar Galaxy. Another galaxy. And then you come to the Pinwheel. And then many, many other galaxies in between. I just pick up a few. Actually, they're very beautiful, pretty galaxies. Right? They're really wonderful. But you know, they're not that small. Our Milky Way is already, how many light years? 120,000 light years in diameter. These are big, big things. And these are creations of our Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. Then Hubble went further, because the telescope can go. They just said, let's go further to see what's happened. And they discovered a beautiful galaxy called the Whirlpool Galaxy. This is a galaxy, the Whirlpool Galaxy. 31 million light years away. 31 million light years away. That means the light that you see from the Whirlpool Galaxy today came to you 31 million light years ago. Right? It's not today's light. It's yesterday's light. Millions of light years ago. And I said, wow, this is a beautiful galaxy. Let's go further. Because the Whirlpool Galaxy is like almost the furthest part they can go. They say, let's go further and see what is beyond the Whirlpool Galaxy. Let's move. Look at that closely. This is what they saw in the galaxy. Slain from the foundation of the world. Slain from the foundation of the world. Put the next slide. See the similarity? All right, back to the next slide. Slain from the foundation of the world. How many years away was this from the foundation of the world? Billions and billions and billions of light years away. Before the world was formed. Long before you decided to do anything for God. Long before. This is what God decided to do for you. Through our majestic and indescribable Jesus Christ. Before he formed you, he already did this for you. And these are the footprints. I guess God knew a time would come that we are able to see the universe. And he put this, maybe right at the end of the universe to show us what he did from the beginning. That's why the Bible said, we don't understand. One day we will. Slain from the foundation of the world. When the world was founded, Jesus Christ was slain. God has no time. We have yesterday, today, and tomorrow. To God, it's all one. Our minds can't comprehend today. But this, the amazing thing is, God has decided what to do for you. Before, long before you decided whatever you want to do for God. You know, before you were formed, this is what God says. Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed. And in your book, they were all written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them. Psalm 139:16. Before you were formed, God already saw you. And all your days were written in a book when you had no days yet. This is what our amazing God did for each one of us, our amazing Jesus Christ, before the foundation of the world. It is awesome. This God that threw stars into space, that called each of the trillions of stars by name, would do this for you. Would mark you before you were even born and have all your days about you written, what you were going to do, where you were going to be born, how you're going to live. This is our God. And today, if you know what a wonderful, indescribable God we have, a Savior we have, what should be your response? What should be your response? Before your days were formed, they were already written in his book. Are you walking in all those things that he's written for you? Have you been obedient? Are you living a life that is glorifying to the Lord? Are you obeying his commandments? I think knowing the enormity and how much God loves us, we must reflect today where we are. Have we been obedient? I would like you all to take some time. Just bow down, close your eyes, and just reflect. Can we do that in the quietness? Just reflect. What have you done for God? Are you living in the plans he has written for you? Have you been obedient? He says, you shall be my witnesses. Have you been witnesses to him? He says, be holy, for I am holy. Have we been living holy lives? Have we been bringing glory to our Lord Jesus Christ for what he's done for us, slain from the foundation of the world? And maybe if you haven't, between you and God, say, Lord, I'm sorry. I've missed the mark. help me. Help me to walk in the plans that you've written for me. All my days you wrote for me before I was born. Help me to fulfill them. When I spend some time and reflect on my life, and I see how short it is, how much I have not fulfilled. You know, wonderful Savior who gave himself for us before even the world was formed. It makes me want to weep that he did this for me and I've fallen short. But God is merciful. If you've fallen short, just say to him and ask him to help you fulfill the works that he's written for you in your life. That in this next phase of life, you walk and catch up in all the things he has for you. Do that between you and God. Between you and God. Father God, we know we've all fallen short of what your plans are for us. But you are a merciful God. We ask for your mercy, Lord. And help us to walk in those plans and purposes you have ordained in our lives, that we might fulfill what you have written for us. That when we stand before you, we can hear those words. Welcome, good and faithful servant. Welcome, good and faithful servant. So the important thing is, how faithful have we been? How faithful have we been? Thank you, Lord, for reminding us. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen.